Hi, everybody. Well, in light of my great successes with my original stuff, hi, one or two people in the next couple of years. Who knows? Anyway, let's have a look at my site. Reason for Paul Hall Art. Protocol, World Wide Web, Paul Hall Art. Some people think it's Paul Hallert. Yeah, that would be sort of like somebody's name, but no, it's Paul Hall, plus the word art, .com. Enter. Let's have a look at art. Literature again. This is what we're doing now. Of course, we got humor. It'd be like an hour of puns, premonitions, how to use art to travel into the future and probably the past. I never thought about that. Let's go on with art literature here. Every literate bit helps. Okay, and I've already done the night I picked up Andy Warhol in my cap, dun-dun-dun-dun. I was sort of like, could have done better with that. Maybe I'll do a retake sometime. The Notorious White Pass, which had a problem there because I realized about the first 10 pictures I had written something about, and I never covered that, so. Anyway. And here, Portrait of an Algebraic Equation. Now, we already did this, but I didn't do it with this cam capture thing. So here is the portrait of the algebraic equation. Now I think it's 3x plus y equals 0 or something like that. I don't know. I forgot. Whatever it is, if you use an xy axis, you see, so the xy axis is shown here by this vertical column, and it's implied by the right angle here. Now all this is drawn by hand. Me did not use rulers. It's all hand drawn. So what I did was I treated everything like a landscape, which probably got the word from the French "landschap." And this is like a landscape of a sunrise. This is like a landscape of a nightfall or something. This is like a landscape of a forest with pine trees. This is the little rock I put on this. You can see the lawn chair, part of the lawn chair I used to take the photo with. Reminds me of the guy who mistakenly, he had chemical film and he took this photo, and when it came back from the developers, it was 25 feet tall, and then he realized his mistake. Instead of taking a photograph, he took a photo giraffe. That's logical. Anyway, so I had to use this stone to keep the picture plane from curling up. You see, the picture plane in those days, here is a picture of me painting on the easel in my leaky Oakland, California studio. It's one of the few, actually that really is the only serious studio I ever had. You know, it's like a dream here in America. I'm sorry, folks, you know, what happens is we've commercialized the heck out of everything, so, I mean, good luck if you want to be an artist. I think the closest you're going to get is something like, you know, some people get through the cracks, but I mean, you're not going to get a Picasso out of the United States. Not the way we're going. You're going to have, at best, something like Mr. Kincaid or Norman Rockwell, as representationalists. I mean, I could go for that. I can do this stuff. This is done quickly in freehand. I used to sleep here on the floor on a piece of cardboard, And if I look hungry, that's because I are in that picture. Deal and I'm going to get into this later. Deal and I used to eat one meal a day, and that was rice with cheese on top of it. And every now and then we used to go down to the Redwood Cafe for a cup of tea. And, I mean, Randall Deal did some spectacular surrealistic stuff. He actually made it, I think, as a surrealist painter. Okay, so let me just shunt that off to the side here, and we'll go back to this thing. I'll go over it real quick, because we already did it. Now, this is out in a lawn chair. The secret is you really have to be a totally professional photographer to take pictures of oil paintings. Because of the shine on oil paints, you have to get the light balanced absolutely correctly. I think what you do is you take a string, you have your lights balanced, you take a string and you hold it from your nose to the center of the painting. If the shadows are equal, something like that, you have to know your Kelvin rates, you have to know your f-stops, you have to know, pi r squared, if you're going to have a cookie pie or something like that. Anyway, so in order to take a picture, the way to get around that, and this is unbelievable but true, is to go outside and take pictures of your photographs in sunlight. Now, I found out later it's not that hard to take digital photographs, but chemical photographs, for some reason, I don't know. But anyway, so if you're going out with your your regular camera, Leica or something like that, 25 mil, or if you're going out with one of these huge ones where you put actual sheet in there, this huge film, where that's the best kind, best resolution, or if you're going out with a little camera at the beginning of the year and it has New Year's resolution, and you don't know your lighting, and you got to know what kind of company makes the film. You got to know, and you have to have lots of experience first. If you can't get that far, just go outside, with your SLR, and take your photographs of your oil paintings in full sunlight. And the only problem is what I got is I got in trouble with the neighbors. The neighbors always solve, a lot of neighbors always solve for the unknown with supposition. And unknown plus supposition equals gossip. So, all I can say is, as soon as we can, we got the hell out of that neighborhood, and I just got rid of my old house, my super big trailer, my money pit, and hit the road. My living room from then on had a stripe painted down the middle of it, going down that old dusty road. So anyway, so here we got this portrait of the algebraic equation. I want to do a lot more of these. This was the beginning of a series, but then I got into my dyslexia, ran into my ADD, and I've never been tested for any of this, but 2x plus 3y equals, I don't know what. So this is like what happens. This is so algebraic equations, you can interpolate them into pictures, and this is sort of like, it's not real cubism. This is a whole different thing. It's linear atmospherics with implied lines and soft lines and hard lines, and maybe some headlines. So this little thing is a rock that has become a part of the composition. And this line here, this line in this section, that you can see, and when you get back a little bit further, because I didn't have much memory on my chip when I took this, you know, it must have been a chip off the old block, but anyway, this line and other lines in here were actually caused by the wind. I was taking it to show my old philosophy teacher. Maybe I'll remember his name. Up until now, I did. so I learned a little bit about pragmatism. Almost got it, tip of my tongue. So what happens is, when I couldn't afford to go to college, my philosophy teacher and a few other people decided that they would let me go in for free, and you know, without all the other bells and whistles of college, you know, where you get, you know, graded and you get a degree and everything. I would just go to art school, and I managed to go through a couple of weeks of that before the other students, you know, how would you say it in slang? They absolutely were livid, or enough of the they that were there. We pay to go here, they say. Yeah, right. Most of them didn't pay to go there. They either, their moms and dads paid for them, or they got loans that they probably would either never be able to pay back, or they would spend the whole life as an art teacher somewhere, which is legitimate, I think, I guess. Anyway, what we got here is, and by the way, you've noticed these backgrounds here. What happens is, I think when people read, and you see this text, if you're reading, you need something to look at, or you might get bored. So what you're doing is, as you're reading this, you're looking at a natural picture, and here actually is the picture. Let's have a peek at that. No, that's a Pekingese. I had a friend once when we were teenagers. He had a chihuahua that he used to put in the freezer for a couple of seconds as a joke. Now, he was an artist too, by the way. You know, spaced artisy. That's the picture. That's actually a photograph using a filter that was supplied by Microsoft back in the... it came with my Front Page software back in 2000. And this... this is the pastel setting on a software called Impressionism. I'm trying to get a hold of that again. What I did is, this is a photograph of some wildflowers that I planted next to a forest in Paddy Hollow up there. Paddy Hollow used to be the pantry for Claremont, New Hampshire, back in from the days of the colonial era, when it was a stagecoach line running from Boston to not Montreal, it was Ottawa, I think. And from that time until, even now, it was a place where animals grazed that were used for meat supply for the town. As you know, they didn't have fridges back in those days, so they had to use an abattoir and go up to Paddy Hollow and get the meat, bring it down to a marketplace, and people would have meat on their table, usually mutton, but they also had a lot of beef and everything. And to this day, they do have beef there. There's one abattoir left, but that's a long story. So basically, all these areas, what you're looking at is behind there, you're actually looking at the forest. Let's see if I can sort of cut it way down. You can actually see the trees of the forest through there. And this area had been clear cut. They still harvest the trees every 20 years or so. And Here's some of the flowers growing there. And what I was going to do is a series of these filters, and I was going to use these filters. Believe it or not, they can teach you how to draw. You know, here you're getting a picture, you're getting a good idea of values, light values. You see these very dark areas in here and the very light areas? Because this is totally realistic. It's actually from a photograph. And here you're getting a way to imply the flowers, you see. So, but you see, it's not just some, it's not an artist doing a representation. This is actually a photograph. So those really are the flowers going through this computer filter. So this is a good way to learn how to do some paintings here. You get a filter like this, you do a couple of these, and then you do the painting. Start off by copying it. But you see, this is, I realize this is how Van Gogh painted. He began to get a kind of, after doing painting for a while, and I got this way too with my landscape paintings. Unfortunately, my landscape sold, so I no longer have them to show you, but, you know, your bread and butter can be your landscape, so I didn't mean for this to be an art class, but you see, your landscapes, or whatever you have, what you're doing is, if you do a series of paintings, eventually you get to the point where you yourself, your mind, the computer of your mind, develops a, quote, filter, unquote. So when you see a picture, it gets transposed through that filter. And arguably, you can have dozens or maybe thousands of different filters to do the paintings with. Kandinsky was an example of that. You know, this is what happens to the landscape painter. And it seems to get abstract, but really it's going through a filter and a lot of other things. So Van Gogh had this filter that he painted based on pointillism. He had a training of, his mentors. I can't go into it now. Let's
get going. Let us.
It's like the joke they said in the retail. One guy said, "You know, can you tell me where the, you know, like Band-Aids are? Oh yeah, it's over here in health, next to health and beauty aids in the pharmacy department." "Oh, thank you so much, young man." And the young man looks up at him and says, "That's quite all right. And if we can help you with anything else, just let us know." And sure enough, it snowed lettuce. Iceberg lettuce. Yuck, yuck, yuck. The berg is the smur, you worg. So let's get back. If you're going to get out of here. I had to have this little stone on the page because the wind would have blown this away. I had it outside on the lawn chair. My mom used to go out there, my elderly mom, this actually the reason why I got this house, this trailer, because my mom in her last years got to have her own private room there after being bankrupted by the Supreme Court of Connecticut. Because they had ruled that the criminal or the contraband of a painting of no contraband violin could be kept by the heirs of either the thief or the person who bought the Stradivarius from the known thief, that for $100. So, you know, the thing is, you know, she lost her house in Connecticut. And she had a nice little room next to, in Paddy Hollow, next to the forest, until they chopped the forest down. But she still had a lovely little garden. It's a long story, as usual. Anyway, so let's go over this portrait of an algebraic equation. I was going to do a series of these. So let's see what I got written here. I'm going to enlarge this. And let's go ahead and make this into a column. See, yeah, it goes back into a column. And let's go ahead and duplicate this tab. I'm going to slide this one over. Let's go for here. Let's enlarge. There's got to be an N here. There's one. Do you see that N in unique? I'm going to press Control and plus, and you see? There it is again. See, it got enlarged. Enlarged. Quite logical, huh? You know how they got logic? They used to live in a lodge, you know, like kind of a teepee, you know. So let's go ahead and this is called restore down. So let's restore down, dairy down, and we're going to use a slider to centralize this, and I'll put that here. We'll put that up here so it can appear out of nowhere. And I know where, huh? Yeah, there we go. This is trouble with sliders. They end up in another dimension. Let's go back here, see what the problem is. So that's probably what happens when you do a duplicate, huh? You get covered with doo, and it's doo-doo. Okay. So, we're going to have to go down, and dairy down. So, okay. Now the only problem with this is I got the color wrong. I was trying to get a color that contrasted with the background. So it kind of backfired on me, but that has backgrounds do back stuff like backfire, back track, back in the shack. So the little white dot at the bottom is a rock used to weigh down the painting once done on cardboard. The cardboard got wet. I was going to tell you about this. And the painting itself peeled off intact. And it's now just a sheet of congealed Liquitex gesso with an oil painting on it. You can do that, by the way. It's kind of like, what's his name? Roger Rabbit, you know, Cartoon Town. This is Painting Town. What you do is, that's why I wanted to show you this thing, which I don't have anymore. It's because, see, here I am painting, and I think, well, obviously, what am I doing here? I'm doing, not painting, I'm doing this drawing up here on my easel. This is an easel we borrowed from the art school, California College of Arts and Crafts. We were just down the street from there, Oakland. And, you know. So, what we did was, I painted on cardboard, and the cardboard got wet, water fell on it, and I thought the painting was destroyed. Fortunately, it wasn't a giant work of art, but to my surprise it peeled off. So actually the painting is a film on a surface, and in this case what happens is the film peels off. So what you can do is get rabbit skin glue and either glue it to a board or to a canvas, So a lot of restorers do that a lot of times. So, okay. A simple mathematical problem, but a deeper approach to it. There are several important things that sputter to the surface all at once, so I'll put them in a random light off the bat, such things as the broader use of heretofore imagined to be superfluous human intellect, the use of the human eye as a supercomputer, the role of aesthetics as a science, rather than consigning it to the dusty shelf of the humanities. The only real humanities they have now that has anything to do with any kind of functionality is motorboating down here in Florida. They run over manatees with the blades, and that's known as Hugh Manatee. They spelled it wrong, though. It's supposed to be H-E-W-M-A-N-I-T-I-E-S, humanities. But anyway, the use of the visual cortex informing memory brain tissue through means of the endocrine system. Now, put that in your pipe and smock it. Your endocrine system gives you causes the memory tissue to form in your brain. It's a reactive thing. Your brain blossoms out to the eyes and to the rest of the extremities of the body through the nervous extension through the spinal column, which is still a part of the brain. You know, the problem is people think of the human being as separate. They've got a brain. You have a brain. Use it. Come on, man. The whole thing is a brain. Basically, it's like we've got this huge walking supercomputer, and each one of us has it, and we only use about the equivalent size of a pea, not one pea in the brain, but about that much, as much as the matter of pea. So a lot of people, when they have to go pee, they pee their brains out, you know. So anyway, I hope you don't mind my type of humor. It's not dry humor. It's you know, the opposite, really. Anyway, okay, the use of the visual cortex forming memory brain tissue through means of the endocrine system. So you use your eyes to form brains. You study. A different kind of studying. What you do this next time is use Google or something, Google visual. And you go to pictures, and you put in the type of pictures you need. And for your subject, you get 10 pictures for each teaching point. And your endocrine system will start to form the tissue. Now, this is still an experiment, in the experimental stage, but if it works out, and I've had a chance to test the theory and try some experiments already, you will be able to go and learn your subjects. You'd be able to do the equivalent of a master's degree in 1.5 years, you know, bachelor's degree in a couple of months, the baccalaureate. Don't go back on those laureates. Anyway, the impact of visual stimulation on the individual's ability to solve problems, and just simply using a concept of a concept to initiate a genre of works of art. Well, they had to do it. They had to look at Einstein's brain. What they found, or so I remember, was that some of his brain's nerve tissue was larger than normal. It's interesting to puzzle somewhat as to the elements involved in that phenomenon. I remember discussing with my professor of visual physiology at Oxford, England, Dr. Whitridge. Gave him one of my paintings, by the way. The probability of the vision's role in the chemical signalization of the human endocrine system. The eyesight had a role to play in the chemical messages in the blood of the bloodstream. That was of particular interest because it's the one sensory organ linked directly to the hormones, directly to the endocrine system. You see, that's the you know, it's like Mr. Neary in Close Encounters of the Third Type says to the guy, hey, how did you know about this part? They're up there on this plateau in the, you know, trying to get to the place where they have the landing strip for the extraterrestrials. And he said, Neary looks at him and smiles and says, next time try sculpturing. Well, this time, next time try painting, because painting, what painting does, and I just forgot what we were talking about, so let's get back to this thing. I'm getting old. I get it down at the local mart. No, I get it at the car, you know, the used car dealer. It's called an old mobile. It's like Calder made a mobile, and it was old, and the car dealer has it down there. It's an old mobile. Anyway, so I'm just trying to fill in for time while I find my place here. All right. So, just an aside here, I mean, that was really exciting being in Oxford, but I had to drop out because, you know, I let guys like Bill Clinton finish their tenure at Oxford. You know, the thing is, Oxford was great, but we were studying the past. The way to study now, the present, you've got to go out into the field and learn for yourself. You do not have time for all that intellectual fun. That was really terrific, but it was good fun, but it's just one of those things, you know. So here we go. The eyesight had a role to play in the chemical mess of bloodstream. So just an aside here, there's another topic along these lines I would like to review in another article. The role of television entertainment, where the visual images of violence are viewed in a comfortable lounge style environment. Got a sociological problem here. By the way, what I was saying is, oh yeah, okay, we finished that one. That is the involvement of manipulated, synthesized stimuli and their role in common contemporary human mental disorders. The subject of such a discussion would be the misassociation of violence with human comfort. Got it? That's the sound bite for you. That sound bite will bite your butt. Anything but. Copy on that one. Okay, the inference is that vision is by no means the whole essence to any given segment of chemical information in the bloodstream, nor can it be isolated. But back to the postulated role of the eyes in the formation of memories and the solution of problems. I suppose that perhaps Einstein and others somehow, perhaps subconsciously, visualized the problems they were trying to solve. And, you know, they always say, oh, I see, huh, right? And that doesn't mean they stepped into a walk-in refrigerator and it's icy in there, huh? You know, it's like, reminds me of the South, they were out there at the you know, Antarctica in the wintertime, and these seabirds would fly over and guys would get concussions, you know. And what happened is, these were seabirds that would do their droppings while flying around through these gale force winds. And, the droppings would freeze on the way down, so these guys were being hit by ICBMs. Anyway, so, yuck, little humor there, huh? Boy, that's a weird interpretation of the good humor man, huh? Look out for the ICBMs, here they come, incoming! Alright, so the problems they were trying to solve, and through the visualization of dyslexia strikes again. I didn't know it belonged to a union. Yeah. It's even though the unions are on their way out, there's no shortage of dyslexia these days. Anyway, I hope the unions get back, but the problem is there is a problem. Let's get to that later. All right. I have to go back over this. I supposed that perhaps Einstein and others somehow, perhaps subconsciously, visualized the problems they were trying to solve And though the visualization may not have come from direct stimulus of light most of the time, okay, in other words, they were able to depict it in their memory or in their mind, still, the gateway from the vision to the endocrine system could have somehow triggered the chemical, quote, messengers, unquote, that the human brain uses to trigger the growth of actual brain tissue used in the physiological formation of actual memory. In a way, the use of visual memory to develop more memory. Now, you see, the thing is, Einstein, for example, was visually rich. How do I know that? One day he was with this writer. Einstein was just arrived, I think, in Princeton, and they were at this lake, and a fish jumped, and Einstein pointed there and pointed to where the fish jumped and said to the guy who only spoke English, and Einstein at that point only spoke German, he said, "Fish!" And the other guy said, "Yeah, fish!" So the guy got to talk to Einstein. You know, Einstein, that's one stein of beer, Einstein. Anyway, in a way, the use of visual memory to develop more memory. See, so it's a treatise I've been thinking of doing called The Role of the Environment in the Process of Human Reason. You see, this is what we're having now. We have this sociological epidemic in the United States. It's just really almost as bad as a disease. And that is, we have an epidemic of the process of human reason being impacted by a synthetic environment, folks. Okay? The problem is synthetic environment, man-made environment, is always necessarily anemic of stimuli. So you're always experiencing stimulus deprivation. What is it called? I forgot. It's something deprivation, you know. Okay, what I'm saying here, however, is that the role of the modern artist has been vastly underrated in the capacity of the niche to encapsulate visual experiences related to the thought process that will enhance the capacity of the any given intellect to solve problems or to reason. So what you do here is you're visualizing mathematics here. This is an effort, a first primitive effort to visualize mathematics by somebody who doesn't have, quote-unquote, an aptitude for math because of my disabilities. I love mathematics, but also mathematics is deficient, by the way. It's limited by the human psychological concept of mathematics. 2x plus 3y does not work in the real world. This works in the ideal humanesque concept that all numbers are equal. In the first place, what we have here is, you see with the trees here and the horizons, we are beginning to look at perspective. We are beginning to look at pi instead of 3.1416 or whatever it is. We're looking at pi as 3, a whole number. And 1, 2, and 3 are the fractional numbers. Okay, so we're number than ever. Let's get going with this. And we got any more groovy stuff? Let's go ahead and have a look at previous. What is that? Let's take a dip. Oh yeah, the night I picked up Andy Warhol in my taxi cab. We already went over that. So, Yeah, that's right, folks. We're a couple of days past the Mayan calendar. The Mayans did have a prophecy of the end. Their prophecy wasn't a calendrical one, because end is not from time, it's from landmarks. And the landmark was... you got to remember, they were religious guys, see. So they said, because the people did not pray, their tools would attack them. So what we have is the Mayans predicting that the tools, such as the computer, what we call the delete key, of the present epoch of terraforming, would be according to this prophecy by these guys up there in the mountain somewhere looking at the stars is all right. The computer attacks the people because they did not pray. So go figure. I mean, they already have computerized machines that can walk around and spray every glowing light bulb human-esque target that, that gives off infrared, which we do, we're infrared light bulbs, with thousands of rounds of, Vulcan cannon, you know. It's the old 50 caliber goes... Oh, that was the old, what you call it, gun of World War II. This is the 50 caliber. Like that. And this is the Vulcan cannon of the 60s. Oh no, I sprayed my computer screen. I hate that. These little rainbow dots appear where it gets wet. Anyway, on that note, now there's a real Mayan for you. As they say, the Maya the merrier. Maybe they'll go to Miami. That's where they have one leg of the Bermuda Triangle, huh?